Okay, so the silicon wafer data set was this one here, let me just bring it up. So what happened with this company was that these were 9 thickness layers on a silicon wafer. These wafers are created using chemical vapor decomposition. And they measure the thickness at those 9 locations of each of the wafers that after. So your data table looks like many, many rows. There's 184 rows, so n is 84, and there's 9 thicknesses in the columns. So k is equal to 9. And building a PCA model, I asked you, let's load in the data, let's take a look at that. So you should work with me as I go through this, if you haven't done it already. So you import the data. And the data set that we had from last week was called silicon wafer thickness. Okay. And you'll see here's the 9 thickness measurements. The first column is just the identifier. So what you would do is you see right now it's thinking that yellow indicates that it's a primary identifier for a new variable. But that first column really isn't actually a variable. It's just an identifier for each wafer. So select that column and just change it to the primary that says this is the primary identifier for this row. Okay? And then along the columns we have G1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Those are the thicknesses of the wafers. Now there's negative numbers in there because this data set is not the raw data. The company was not willing to give the raw data. They only gave the centered and scaled data. So this data is actually already centered and scaled. That's why we see a few negative thicknesses. But we know that centering and scaling does not change the correlation structure of the data. After centering and scaling, you can still see what's going on in the data set. So this is a good way to give data to someone else. If you're ever concerned about security of it, you just center and scale it and give them the data. They can still do everything they could have done with it, but you've hidden your units, and you've hidden some of the true variability in the data set.
So is there a way to go back to the
No. If you don't know what the mean centering vector was and what the scaling vector was, you cannot undo this. Right? So this is often when we work with companies, we say to them, don't worry about the privacy, just give us the centered and scale data. It doesn't break anything because the first step we would have done with it anyway in the software is to center and scale it. So this is why there's negative values there. So once you say okay, you finish that import. Now you can go take a look at the columns here. And the software allows you to pre-screen each variable. So what do you notice about the thicknesses at position 1 here? Anything unusual there?
This outlier?
Yeah, a big outlier, and probably a few others over here. Okay. Now if we go to observation 2, that outlier is again over there. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Every time that outlier seems to be in the same position, roughly position 40-something. And there's one just next to it over here also. So we get this consistent outlier over there. I know in the software, I believe you can select this already over here now, and you can click remove. But don't do that just yet. We don't want to do that. I want you to actually keep the outlier in, and we'll see what happens in PCA when you have such a big outlier. Okay, so don't remove it. Just click OK to go to the next screen. It asks you to save. Okay, and then as before, we land up at this window, which allows you just to preview the data. We've got 9 variables. We can go see what those are. G1, they're in a slightly different order. 8 and 9 are there in the middle. You can see a few summary statistics, mean, standard deviation, so on. And then everything else we just keep as is. And you say okay. And we give our first model name, initial PCA. And just to verify once more, we've got A is equal to 0, 0 components fit 184 observations of 9 variables.
Can you turn the brightness down of that light? Is that possible?
Oh, sure. So the next step is to go use the auto fit function.
K sometimes gets changed, is it?
Yeah, k is the number of columns, so in this case we have 9 thickness measurements.
Wait, it says it's something wrong there. Say, it says 10.
Well, then you know that you've imported, probably you know that first column that said 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. You didn't set that as an observation ID. So if you want, is that what you have?
Yeah, I have.
I guess you could. The best is now just to go file new and start over again. Remember the ring to set that. But it's important to go do that because,
yeah.
I mean, otherwise you've got this column that's going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It doesn't mean anything. It's not a true variable. So just, you can start over if you want to catch up with this thing.
Yes.
Okay, so order fit then fits 4 components with pretty good R squared for all of them. But let's go take a look at what would we look at next after you fit a PCA model? What would be your next step too after this? To go investigate.
Add another component to see
you could go add another component, but what are you going to, you've just fit this model, what would be your next step to want to go see?
Loading.
Yeah, loadings plots,
yeah.
Scores plots.
Yeah.
So those are all up here. Remember we said last time you go to the analyze menu and you work your way down. So you can go look at component summary, which will just regenerate this window for you, so I'm not going to do that. You can go look at variable summary, which will show you, if you just say okay then, it will show you the R squared and the Q squared for every single variable in the model using 4 components. So we can see those 9 thickness measurements are well explained. Pretty much here's one almost 100% explained by those 4 components right now. Okay? But what we're really interested in is, let's go take a look at the scores plot. So we go to analyze score plot T1 versus T2, add that series, and we say, okay, what do you see here now? Four outliers, okay? And then what we expected, remember we said that observation at about 14 and 39. So we've got wafer 39, wafer 40, wafer 110, 155. So you see this in your score plot, what would you like to know next? Okay, and how do you find outliers and outliers? Absolutely, okay, so which one first? C39. So remember we circled that and then we use this little guy over here, create contribution plot. And what is this, what would you interpret from this? Remember a contribution plot is, what is the contribution plot finding for us? This, right, so this is the nice thing about the latent variable model is we're now in this 4-dimensional space. A, we've got 4 components, but we can't really interpret what a large T1, T2, T3, and T4 is all the time. So a contribution plot is our link between the real world and finding out which variables in the real world lead to these problems out here in the score. So this contribution plot shows up that pretty much every variable is a problem. So it hasn't really eliminated anything from us, but that's because observation 39 genuinely is an unusual data point in pretty much every single one of these 9 columns. Okay. Now, let me just go plot up the raw data here. This is silica wafer thickness. So it's observation 39. I'm just going to pick it out here in Excel. It's over there. And remember observation 40 was as well. We might as well look at observation 39 and 40 simultaneously. So you can see the problem with that, right? All the other data is this nice numbers plus or minus 0, and then you get this one here of 7, with 7s and 8s and 9s, and 7s and 8s in it, and then the second row, observation 40, has 2s and 3s. So it's way bigger. In all 9 columns, it's got this very large outlier over there. So that was those two, observation 39 and 40. Who wants to interpret this contribution plot for 155? Tell me what's going on here with one observation 155.
Just the one measurement was contributing to the error.
Yeah, so just the measurement at location 6 on the wafer. So let's just double check that 155. Was it 155?
Yeah, this is important.
So it was G6. Okay, over there you see that 4.4 something. So it picks up that the rest of them are okay. It's just that location. I've got my column shuffled around. Yeah, so it's column G6. Okay, so you would and then you would go and interrogate 111 as well. Circle that in red and then do the contribution. It's only showing the first 5 positions and maybe G6 as well to some extent, but definitely the first 5 are more problematic. So if you go back here and you can see where's position 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, just the center thicknesses that have gone. So this is a wafer that if you looked at it sideways would probably be something like that. Okay, so PCA has found those 4 outliers. Now, your inclination would be to then go remove them, right? Because especially this observation 39 is really distorting the score space. I mean, it's distorting the model almost to some extent. Remember when we looked at least squares in the class, we had this idea of particular observations having large influence on the model. Remember, those were the ones that were able to pull the whole least squares model towards themselves. If you plotted up something in least squares, and the reason why I'm looking at least squares is because remember behind the scenes all that PCA is a whole series of least squares. We showed that in the last class with the root knot algorithm. So if you've got observations like this that, and then you've got one out here, the least squares model is going to go something like that. This observation has pulled the whole model towards itself over here, whereas really the more appropriate model would have been something over there. So it's really not in our interest to keep observation 39 in the model. Now, just before I go and remove them, one other thing that we can go to take a look at is the squared prediction error for this model. Because this is going to tell us how far away from the model plane each observation falls. And if observation 39 is close to the model plane, what's that going to tell you? Before I show SPE, if observation 39, for example, was very close to the model plane, in other words, a very small SPE, how would you interpret that?
Did that mean that it caused the model to shift towards
itself? Yeah, it pulled the model so close to itself that its residual distance is small. It would be like this case. The residual for this observation is tiny. So it's got such strong leverage on the model that it pulls the whole model towards itself. So we can go see that, and yeah, 39 doesn't show up as an SPE outlier. But the only one of these 4 big outliers that shows up is 155 over here. So this is definitely a problem to this observation 39, 40, and a few of these others. We should definitely go remove them. So the software's got a nice feature that you can select things in the score plot. So you just go and create a lasso type thing over around those data points, and then you release your mouse and it selects all 4 of them. Okay? So if you, yeah?
Just further on that point 39, I understand that it can pull the model towards itself and that's why its SP could be low, but what if its SP was low because it was, that was a true point?
Well,
like that you had some.
I guess in certain situations I could see that being the case. It's on the model plane, but just far off on the periphery with a low SPE. But in this case, we know 39 is so inaccurate. We've looked at the raw data and we've verified that. So we know then that's problematic. But I agree with you, there are certain cases where data points have large influence on the model, but they're on the model plane. But they're usually closer to here. This is
it's pretty extreme.
It's very, very extreme case, and we know. So a lot of it is also to do with judgments of your unprocessed data, but it definitely can happen that you get what are called large T-squared values, but they're small SPE. They're on the model plane. Okay, so once you've selected those four data points, there's this little garbage can over here at the top, select, exclude, selection, and you click on that, and we take a look at, it brings up this window for you, remember like we had last time, and we've pretty much been just ignoring what this window contains every time. Every time it just internally goes okay, and we build a model. Let's go take a peek here. Variables is still the same as what we had before, it's got the 9 variables. But now you notice in work sets, there's a small difference. It's gone and put those 4 observations we've selected in this list called available observations. So in other words, these have now been excluded. The remaining observations have been included in the data set. And at this point, you could also go and say pick observations, other observations, and click that black arrow over there and set them out, take them out the model. So this is, once we've done here, this is going to be our training set or our model building data. Hit OK and prompts us, so we can just write here now PCA after excluding outliers. And we've got this model 2 going over here. And now just say, verify that N is 180. We've dropped out 4 of our rows have dropped out, so now we're down to 180 rows. And we go auto fit that guy. So again, it picks up 4 components for us. Now, I'm just gonna leave that up there because I'm gonna come back to it in a minute. If we go plot the score plot, there's this shortcut function over here to get T1, T2. We can see now a more reasonable distribution of points in that score space. Okay, so just a question here. If the first component here is explaining around 80%. Given that the objective of this system that's producing these wafers, you would presume, or actually it is, the objective of producing these silicon chips would be to make wafers that are identical thickness every single time. Because then these units then go downstream and get operated on, and we know that the wafer manufacturing industry works at the nanometer scale. So you really want every single wafer to be exactly the same thickness. Now, given that as background, we know that what PCA is doing is explaining variability in the data. And we know as process engineers, what we want is no variability. We want beautiful flat lines, okay? But this is showing us that whatever variability is in the system here, it's being picked up in the first component, there's some sort of variability. We'll call this is a plot of time, say, or wafers, wafer order, wafer 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and this would be T1. This plot, or T1 rather, is explaining 80% of the variance in the data set. So if you're looking at quality or manufacturing systems for this particular case, your major objective would be next to interpret what T1 is and get rid of it. Because every single measurement we have in this data set is the thickness of the wafer. So if you're aiming for flat lines, you're aiming to get a PCA model with no components, right? Think about it, if this is your system and you wanted wafers with perfect thickness, you would want a PCA model with 0 components. Basically, there's just noise in your system or no systematic variation. But we're seeing here that the first component, T1, explains 80% of the variance. T2 explains an additional 4-5%, and then each additional component, well actually here's the actual numbers. So the first component is explaining 82%, the next component adds an additional 4%, then another 4% from the third component, and then 3.3% from the fourth component. So if I was in quality control here, I wouldn't really be focusing too much on T2, T3, and T4. I would be spending all my energy getting rid of T1, because I want constant operation. Okay? So let's go take a look at what this T1 is. If I want to interpret T1, what's the plot what I put up? If I want to interpret or understand what T1 is, what T1 is modeling, what do I show as my, what do I use to try and figure that out?
Variable summary.
Variable summary? So, yeah. So, variable summary shows me which, how much R squared, well, how much am I staying on each variable? So, yeah, maybe, but I'm not going to tell you what T1 means. Do you want to understand what T1 means?
The loading is plot.
Yeah. So, the loadings plot shows us that. Now, you can go plot P1, and there's another shortcut over here for it. P1 has a bar plot. So, what's your interpretation of this component? And if you wanted to give this in layman's term to someone, to say T1 describes, you're on the right track. So if every thickness contributes equally,
the average thickness.
Yeah. So the average of something would be the sum of those divided by n. In this case, n would be about, so that's divided by 9. We're taking 9 thicknesses. So we're saying 1/9 times the thickness of the first component, first thickness 1/9 times the second thickness 1/9, the third thickness. But remember, we've got this constraint that p must, the sum of squares of p must be equal to 1. So that's why these values are not all, they're not close to 1/9, but they're closer to this 1/3, 1/3. If you take the sum of squares of 9 1/3, you'll probably get some number close to 1. So you can easily interpret this first component as the average thickness. So that's kind of a bit of a letdown, because you were hoping that T1 would explain something that you can act on, but all that it's saying here is that, well, no, T1 is really just the average thickness of your wafer. So in some ways, it's a little bit of a letdown, because it's not showing you, like, it's due to position 8, or it's due to position 6. It's showing you if the whole thickness of the wafer is getting thicker and thinner simultaneously. And that may be also useful, right? Because you could interpret that in some way. And in this case, the company was Motorola in the US, where this data is from. And Motorola knew that the average thickness means it's just the time duration that is inside the reactor. So as the longer the wafers are inside the chemical vapor decomposition unit, the thicker and thicker they're becoming. So if they want to control for constant thickness, they need to control how they set the time that each wafer is inside the reactor. So that's the first component. Now, one thing that's actually quite interesting is if we've got that interpretation that T1 is the average thickness, well, let's go plot T1 and see what it's doing over time. So we've always looked at score plots like T1, T2, like this, and that's fine, but we're losing the time dimension when we do that. So if we want to understand a bit of the time sequence in the data, the way to do that is over here. So you go analyze score plot, same as before, but before you just hit add series, just change this drop down over here. Change that to range. Okay. So that will then plot on the x-axis the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 up to 180. And then we want to look at T1 and probably look at it as a line plot. So once you've made all those settings, then you can hit add series and then you hit OK. Now, I noticed this when I was preparing for the class that I get this. I don't know if you guys get that on yours. Okay, so the easiest way to change it is just right-click on there and choose properties. I think it's just a small bug. And just change the y-axis minimum and maximum. So the x-axis is going to go from 0 to 216. That's the order of the numbers. But just change this to minus 10 and plus 10. That's the range of the T1 on T1. And hit apply, and you get something a bit more useful. Okay, so let me just rearrange some windows here. So now we're looking at T1 in time order. And actually, it shows it up to you kind of as a control chart, right? You guys would probably recognize this from the class. It's almost like a control chart. This is the 95% limits, and these are the 99% limits. And we know that 3 sigma would correspond to 99.9, 2 sigma corresponds to about 95. So you can see this as the 2 sigma and 2 point something sigma, 2.5 kind of control limits. So let's assume these are the control limits for T1. What characteristics do you notice about the time order here for the data? Emily's not allowed to answer. No one's following. Yeah, I think you know as well from the previous time. So what do you notice about T1? So we're plotting here on the x-axis the sequence in which we acquire these data. If you were the process engineer responsible for this line, remember you're aiming for something that's roughly zero, right? You would, if T1 is equal to zero, it just says that thickness is at the average level, right? Remember we've said that before, that the T value at zero corresponds to the average.
I think that as we did it before, test and probe. We have the outlier over there, we take it out, and then now we are inside the limit for the next.
Keep going. But yeah, that's what you would be doing if you were setting up a control chart. That's a good point. But even before we go to that, is there something interesting you notice in these data?
It seems like if one's high, then the next one's low, and crisscrossing.
Yeah.
Crisscrossing the zero
point. Yeah. So if you think a bit about that, what might be happening in the process?
Of course, it's like trying to self-correct when it goes too high and when it goes too low.
Okay, yeah, exactly. There's some sort of correction factor in here, and it's overcompensating a bit, right? In fact, if I remember, well, if I understood this correctly from what's happening here, there's a person doing this. So it's not actually a computer, or it's not automatic. But it's an operator who takes the batch out, measures the thickness afterwards, and then he or she goes and makes a correction for the next time the batch is running. So from a process control point of view, we would say the gain is too high. You're overcorrecting. Yeah, you're oscillating.
It would be nice to have that attendant operator.
Yeah, well, I guess here each silicon wafer batch is worth millions of dollars. They probably have, if I remember John describing this once, he was saying that they would have a paper there next to the reactor that says, if you take this out and you measure these thicknesses, then run the next batch at these conditions. So whatever that instruction sheet was giving them was overcompensating. Yeah. So they just needed to go change that. And when they were looking at this data, John McGregor was using this data set at an industrial course at Motorola, and they were looking at this data. They just got that data that day. The engineers actually went out to the plant right then and corrected that problem. But this was the first time they really saw it so displayed like that. So this is a great way to look at a summary of 9 variables. In this case, it's something that you would probably see a little bit obvious just to take the average thicknesses and plot those out in time. But from a quality control point of view, we're seeing that 80% of, if the number was up here, 82% of all our variability in the process is just due to this phenomenon. So this is the first place to go make a change. Now, say you go get rid of this and you reduce this dramatically, then your next shot at making this process a little bit more stable would be to go look at T2. We can do this because each component is orthogonal to the other. Whatever you're correcting in T1 is totally independent of T2, right? That's why we like PCA for this, because it's breaking up variance into independent phenomena. So if we go correct the problem in T2, we're not going to be changing any of the other problems on our process or introducing any new problems either. So let's go visualize what T2 is. We'll go look at the loadings plot for that guy. So analyze loadings plot, and we're going to show a bar plot of P2. So we add series, and we say okay. Guesses for what T2 is doing, explaining in the model. Someone want to think what's going on here? What is P2 explaining? So G8 is the major source of whatever's changing in P2 is due to position G8 on the wafer. So if we go back and just take a look at the layout of the wafer, something is happening so that the top point, top corner of that wafer is a little thicker, right? So G2 is positive, and so G8 is positive. So these are thicknesses. The fact that it's a positive weight says that every time we're seeing a high value of thickness at location 8, T2 is going to be higher. Remember, T2 is just a linear combination of these weights. So we take the thickness at position 1 times the thickness of position 2, thickness of position 3, until we get to position 8. So whatever's going on at position 8, you can visualize it as follows. So these are the 9 thicknesses in your disk. They're all going up and down, but G8 is just going a little bit further. Remember, the predominant variation is all the up and down together, but this position at G8 is just going a little bit extra because it's something in addition to whatever's going on in the first component. Another way you can understand this is, remember last week we spoke about deflation and with the Nepal's algorithm. After we've calculated the first component, we remove that variance from the model. So P2 here is explaining something that's gone beyond P1. It's in addition to P1. You'll remember this equation from last week. We had that x hat is equal to T1 P1 transpose plus T2 P2 transpose. So this phenomena of G8 is whatever's it's added to or on top of the average thickness moving up and down. So this is an additional phenomenon that we're seeing. But it's a small phenomenon, it's only explaining 4%. And I think it turns out in this case what it was is that this position on the wafer was closest to one of the jets that was introducing the chemicals into the reactor. So it did become slightly thicker at that location than all the rest of the wafer. Okay, so G2, if we go try and figure that problem out in our process, we would go fix that up and try to eliminate that problem. But let's go take a look just before we leave this case study at the time series for T2. So let's go plot up like we did for T1, and now this is a score plot that we want to show as a line plot. Change this to range in T2. We add series. So we're going to add a line plot against range of T2. Okay, and then you get this glitch. Just change under properties here, change the y-axis to -5 and +5. But you could probably even go in tighter, -2 and +2, I think would even work. Yeah. Okay, so everyone's got that up. Anything interesting you notice in this plot? These are the time ordered values of T2.
Compensate also.
So this is taken in time, right? So this is at the start of the period, and this is at the end.
It seems like they might have had over control at first, but they adjusted for it. It seems like they don't have it as much.
Okay. Yeah. So yeah, this yeah. Okay, that's I've never noticed that before. Actually, yeah, there's bigger oscillations at the start, and then as they come in at the end, those problems become smaller. Good point. But there's a and then there's the other thing, right, that's going on here is that there's this constant slow upward trend in T2. So this problem with G8, position G8, is actually under the average in the start of the period, and it gets larger and larger over time. So there may be some slow disturbance, some fouling on that nozzle, or something that's causing a slow drift in the process in G2. Okay? So this is what we've done here is standard, right? For any of you that are looking at data that's acquired in order of time, your scores, T1 and T2, are also now in time order, and they're a far more efficient summary of the data than your raw data was. So once you've calculated the PCA model on your raw data, plot out T1 and T2 this time, SPE. If you like to see it just visually this way, you've got your raw data X, and you've now gone and you've calculated T1, T2, maybe T3, T4, and then you've got a column SPE. You have another column T squared, hotel is T squared. So you use these variables now instead of your raw data to explore your model, to explore your data set, to understand what's going on in your process. But you have to remember what you're doing here. T1, T2, T3, these are explaining directions of variability. SPE is kind of like a residual, and T squared is a summary of all your scores in one go. Or as we put it in a previous class, I showed a picture where T squared can be interpreted as the distance from the center to the observation on the model plane. So it's a distance measurement in this a-dimensional space. You're going all the way up to TA over here. Okay, so everyone feeling comfortable with getting the scores up and excluding observations from your model. That was the two main objectives with this case study was how to deal with outliers and how to read some of these outputs from the software. Okay. I just want to show another feature with the next case study. This one you'll recognize from the take-home exam. So let's move to question 5 on page 13. So this is that case study where, let me just bring it up here, where we had the supplier for your companies, you've got these six measurements, size 5, 10, and 15, with size measurements of the plastic pellets. And then you had three other measurements. You had this TGA, DSC, and TMA measurement. So these were just thermomechanical properties of the plastic, as well as a scanning value from DSC. And in addition to that, we had this outcome, which is not so clear, but you had some engineers saying this battery is adequate or poor yield. So you looked at that in the take-home exam, and you had to just do some straightforward PCA on that. Let's take a look at it here in the software, though. So let's go to New, File New, and import the data. So if you've got it downloaded, it's called Raw Material Characterization. CSV. Open that up as normal data. Okay, and then the software may not, doesn't pick up that column. It excludes it because it just sees words here. But what you should do is just select that column and set it to your secondary identifier. So each row can have a primary identifier, in this case the lot number, and then the second identifier for that row is this designation of whether it's an adequate batch or a poor batch. Okay? And then you've got your six measurements after that. So if you hit OK now and then click finish, so everyone's up to this point. Then you can go take a look at your data here, your raw data, column by column. You guys have that in the back there? Okay, so we'll just save that. Okay, so we've got here that there's six variables in the X block, which we expect. There are six over there. And then the observations, there's all these lot numbers over here that we had from before. You hit OK. And we can call this model the initial PCA. So I'll just wait for you. Like everyone's got to this point. You guys have the... Do you have the data set?
I'm running with my software, it's not working.
Oh, did you, was that last week as well that you had the issue?
Yeah, but I got it. It's my fault. It's
okay. Oh, okay. So just let the guys know if you can't get it going. Okay. So everyone's up to this point, right? So, yeah.
Normal data,
yeah. We're not dealing with batch data in this process. Okay, so then let's use AutoFit and take a look. So there's three components by cross-validation. And the first question I asked was to build the latent variable model, use AutoFit, and then we can go interpret those two components. So you did this, you had this in the take-home exam. This may look a little bit different to what you got from R. If you use R, you had this flipped. It was flipped 180 degrees. And that's sometimes surprising to people, is why can I get this PCA model that it's... what's happened is that P1 has just switched signs. You're not seeing positive P1, you're seeing the flips of P1. And that's because, just so that you're aware of that, it happens sometimes even on the same computer. You can open it on a different day and you'll get your model looking the opposite. If you just take a look at this, you could write that also as negative T1, negative P1, and those two cancel out, is equal to X hat plus negative T2, negative P2, transpose here. So it's no problem if you get the signs flipping, but because your scores would be flipped as well, your interpretation of the model is still going to be consistent. It's just going to be, you're just going to be saying negatives instead of positives. Okay, so in the take-home exam, I was just marking it this weekend, and pretty much everyone figured out that the size variables were very highly correlated with each other, that the DSC was oppositely correlated to the TMA and TGA, and that those two were tightly correlated with each other. So that was, that's a no-brainer. This was a six-dimensional system, you've got six measurements, but we're seeing here you can capture, what was it, about 80% of the variance with just two components. And then if there is a third component, a small third component, that takes it up to 90%. So you really don't have to measure all six measurements, there's a much smaller space in which the system is moving. Now T1 and T2, look like that, and I'd asked in the exam to color code these plots, and a lot of people just used Excel or R to do it, but you can also do it here in the software. That's why I wanted to, that's my only reason for using this data set here, was just to show this feature of the software. So right click on the plot, and go to properties, and down at the bottom here there's this coloring subsection, and you can color the plots by, in this case, there's that outcome variable that we pulled in as a secondary identifier is now available to color code your plot line. So that's why I emphasized that earlier on. So if you hit apply or okay, now you can see these darker points over here are where is poor quality and then the rest of the data points are adequate quality. So if you were developing a system, remember what was happening in this case study was that you were getting batches of material, you were taking these six measurements and then running them through your process, and sometimes they were performing badly. So if you wanted to, you could develop a system and says, anytime I get a batch that's, you could draw a diagonal line over here, anytime I get a batch that's sort of in this upper region over here, I'm going to not use that batch. I'm going to maybe send it to another part of my process where, which is not so sensitive to this problem. Or if you're a big enough purchasing power, you can just send it right back to your supplier and tell them, look, I want better quality stuff. I want you to always send me things that are in this region of the score space. Just a little story here. I based this case study on an actual problem that I worked at a company. And with this company, every one of these data points was $1 million. That batch was 20 kilograms, it was worth $1 million. And they did send it back to their supplier who was in the UK. Or and in some places, their supplier was in India. So this is a very real system, right? What this company ended up doing was that they told the supplier, take those measurements and type them into this website, and then the supplier saw, okay, hang on, this batch is in the bad region, we're not even going to bother sending it to them because they're not going to want it. So this is one very powerful way you can use these tools, is to, it's what's called multivariate specifications. You specify, well, firstly, you have to realize that by taking six measurements, is not six independent pieces of information. There's really only a two-dimensional space here, T1 and T2. You're not really in a six-dimensional space. If you're in a two-dimensional space, you can draw a region in this two-dimensional space that says, if you're in this area, you're going to be bad. If you're in this area, it's okay. Okay? Now, obviously, you can't go to your supplier and tell them, I want T1 values of -4 and T2 values of -2. They're going to be, I don't know. So how do you translate those specifications back to real-world units? Contribution plot? Yeah, contribution plot could help. You could say, this point's a good point. What are good points look like? So let's go take a look. So you can go select that point, do a contribution for it. So it tells you a good data point has small size values, a low DSC, a high TGA, and high TMA. And you can go do that for a few of those data points. So that's that one. You could also say, well, this is also a good data point here. But this one's now slightly different, right? So it's saying still a small 10, but size 5 and 15 are not so important. TGA is important, TMA is important. DSC now is moderately important. The previous one, DSC, was very negative. So, well, this is a little bit confusing, but let's go try another one then, right? Well, this one says none of the size measurements are important, but TGA and TMA seems to be high and DSC needs to be low. So, what did you do?
Go to the back to the loading plot.
Loading plot.
You have to give you the real.
Well, yeah. Okay. So the contribution plot gives you specific changes from one data point to the average, for example, like we did in this case. But the loading plot gives you the generalization. And the reason why I'm emphasizing that is because remember the t's, what we're plotting to the t's, they're a linear combination of the x's, right? So t1 is equal to x1 times p11 plus x2, which in this case is size 10, times its weight, p2 plus so on. And we have six of these terms. You can get a small t1 by changing any one of those six terms, right? So a contribution plot is showing you specifically why one particular data point, what its terms were. But a loading plot is telling you in general how you can get a negative T1 and a, so we want a negative T1 and a negative T2. So let's plot the loading plot. So how would you get a negative T1 and a negative T2? what would you do?
Is there a way to superimpose the numbers like that?
No, I don't, I've tried to look for it, but I can't see it over here. Negative 1 and negative t2, how would you do that?
Push.
Sorry?
Pushing?
Oh, no, I'm asking here, based on this loading plot, how would you tell your supplier in, say, Vietnam or some other place, you know you want a small T1 and a small T2, but you need to convert this back to something that you can talk about as an engineer. What would you say to them? I want batches with...
So that means with the TM, because you will go TMA and TGA.
TGA. You want, how should they be?
Should be like negative values. Was this value like projected to the T1?
Okay, so let's take a look. We know we want to be somewhere in this region, right? So what should our size values be? You want small sizes.
Negative correlation.
Yeah, or you want small sizes because a small size, a negative size below average size times the positive weight is going to give you a negative T1. Okay. So you want small sizes. You want large values of TMA and TGA, high values of TMA and TGA, to get your negative T2, because TMA and TGA have a negative T2 value. So to get a negative T2, you need a large TMA and a large TGA value. And you want big TMA, big TGA, and small sizes. Okay, we saw that in some of the contribution plots that we had small sizes and we had large values of TMA and TGA. Let's go take a look again to verify that. So if we took that data point over there, its contribution plot showed that it did have small sizes and, well, in this case, TMA and TGA were positive, but not that, they weren't that important, and it had a negative DSC. If you look at this data point over here, it had large positive TGA and TMA. So that we're seeing that confirmation in the individual contributions. But if you did want to give general advice to your supplier, that's what you would ask for. Is that?
Yeah. I'm confused about the DSC because it's on the negative on the P1, but it's on the positive on the P2.
Okay, so DSC then it's going to cancel out. It seems right. So you wanted high in the one and low in the other, it's going to show you at the end that DSC needs to be at average. Yeah. Let's take a look. If you want to be down here, in terms of T1, DSC needs to be positive. And in terms of T2, DSC needs to be negative. So it's going to cross out. In fact, if you go look at all the data points that were poor quality batches, their DSC, if you go look at all the data points that have adequate quality batches, which is what you're aiming for, their DSC values were all over the place. So it's also showing you that DSC probably isn't that important to determining what the quality outcome is going to be. In this case, DSC is insensitive. It's just one of those variables that just doesn't matter. Now, I'm sort of inclined to just keep going a little bit with PCA just to emphasize a few more data points before we go into PLS, because we have another 2 weeks. I can easily go and spread PLS over 2 weeks, and I'd rather do that. How do you feel about doing that? Are you guys finding this boring? Do you know all this stuff, or do you want me to move on to the new stuff?
This is good.
This is okay. Because I would rather you, I know like Emily and Hopkins, and like you guys have probably done a lot of this in outside the class already. But I want to, there's a few points in here that I really want you to be clear on before we move on. Now, I want to redo this case study because as I was marking this over the weekend, some group I think in the class did something that I thought was quite interesting, and it leads into a point that I meant to cover last week but didn't have time. Let's go open this data set all over again. So go file new project. Import data. And I put a new file on the website that is called raw material characterization with binary outcome. Did you all download that? Do you have that? Yeah. Use that file this time. It's exactly the same data, it's just an Excel file. And the reason for that is because we treat that as normal data. What this does is I've gone and put in outcome. I've changed it from being poor or adequate, I've changed it to a 0-1 variable. Okay? I put a 1 when it was good and a 0 when it was bad or poor. Okay? I want to look at it, this case study, because last week I had intended to cover, I believe it's on page 7, I had a little section there on indicator variables that talks a bit about how we can include these binary variables inside your latent variable model. You just treat them like any other variable you can do. And one person did this in the take-home exam and got the same answers, and I wanted to show why you get the same interpretation. Okay, so if all of you guys got, do you guys have that? Okay, so once you've imported it, you get outcome as a 1 or a 0. So let me just make a note here, 1 is 0. That, and actually, if you import from Excel, it gives the block name or something like that. You can just leave it like that and say finish. Okay, and when you scroll across here to the end, you'll see you've got this additional column called out preparations. So if you plot this column, you'll see there's the poor batches, batch 6, 7, 8, 9, and there you go back down like that. Okay. So we treat this variable like any other variable. It's also going to be centered and scaled. The software is not going to treat it any differently. So what would you imagine happens when you center a variable like that?
Cancel out the
mean. Cancel out what?
Like an average.
So where would the mean be?
Not for the
Yeah, it depends really on what the balance is between the ones and zeros, right? If you've got a roughly equal number of ones and zeros, your mean is going to be over here. And then standard deviation is going to be whatever. So after centering and scaling, you're going to have numbers here that are, say, minus 0.5 and plus 0.5, something like that. So in the notes on page 7, when I talk about indicator variables, I say you can do this, you can bring this in as a usual variable, provided you've got okay balance. There's no hard and fast rule, but for example, this would be bad if you've got a whole lot of ones and only one zero. Because now where's your mean? Your mean is up here somewhere, right? Your mean of those data points is up there, and your standard deviation is going to be the sum of squares of these distances and then this. So there's going to be a large standard deviation, and sometimes it depends really, it might even be a small standard deviation. So after scaling, it's uncertain what this looks like, but from mean centering, this is going to be an awkward variable to work with. So my only guidance is that when you bring in an indicator variable, the 0-1 variable, try to have some sort of balance. But again, there's no rules like you need 50-50, like you don't need 50. You could get away with 30-70. But I would say like 90-10 is starting to push it a little bit. You can still get good results with 90-10, but it really just try to bring in some sort of balance. Or at least when you're looking at this variable, be aware of what's gone on behind the scenes with the centering and scaling. Otherwise, just treat it like any other variable. There's nothing special about it. Okay, so we've brought that in. This out. So now we've got a seventh variable outcome. Then you can see the mean is 0.7, the standard deviation is 0.4. So use this to kind of screen for what's going on. the last thing you want, remember we divide through by the standard deviation to scale. So if this standard deviation is a very small number, you could blow up that variable and create variance where there really isn't any variance. So just take a look at that sometimes. Okay, otherwise this is exactly like we did before. We can just say PCA with indicator. And we can auto fit the model. I think there's still three components as we had before. And if you plot, let's plot P1 as a bar plot. What does that tell you now about how to produce good quality product and bad quality product?
You just want a small size.
From the first component's point of view, right, you just want small sizes. That seems to be the overwhelming deciding factor from the first component. So the first component is explaining, let's take a look here, 44% of the variance. Is three components that take up to 90%, but about half of the variance, 44 over 90%, half of the variance that's considered significant by cross-validation, half of that variance is showing you could probably just use the three size variables to make a determination. Okay, let's take a look at P2. So analyze, loading plot. Let's interpret the second component. Plot P2 as a range. What's the interpretation of P2? Yeah. So and maybe a small amount of negative DEC, but you would, to get outcome being high, in other words, you want outcome equal to adequate, you would need to operate with higher values of TGA and TMA. You would ask your supplier, whatever that means, back in, like TGA is just a number from a machine. For those of you that deal with plastics, TGA is a device in the lab that spits out this number, but you can relate it back to the physical properties of the plastic, and you can ask your supplier, give me a plastic so that when I put it through the TGA, I'm gonna get higher numbers, and they would know how to translate that back to tweaking their process to give you that material. So this is the second component, only it explains 33%, and it's orthogonal to the size. That makes sense, right? You can adjust the size of the plastic pellets independent of what the laboratory machine is going to give you. If you're going to put in small plastic pellets or big plastic pellets, you're still going to get the TMA and TGA values, the same thing. And that's why the first component and the second component are orthogonal to each other. Yeah. So in summary then, to tell your supplier, I want, let's take a look here, you want a large value of outcome, in other words, a plus one. So to get that, you need to have the opposite, small values of the sizes. And to get a large outcome, you need positive or above average TGA, TMA, below average TSC values. And so you're kind of getting that same interpretation that we did from not even including the outcome variable. This time though, we're putting in the outcome variable, PCA is forced to also explain it, so it's those latent variables, those loadings are going to be in a similar direction but slightly moved because there's now the seventh variable that it's also got to explain. And we're going to see that this afternoon when we get to PLS, we're going to make the outcome variable our Y variable and try to predict outcomes. So we're going to try and make our latent variables move even more into this direction that explains good and bad outcome. When we just put all the seven columns into a PCA, the model is just building a model that explains the greatest source of variance. Outcome is not necessarily in that highest direction of variance. But by including it at least in the model, we're asking PCA kind of go in this direction with outcome. The first PCA model that we built just before this didn't even have outcome. It just had these six six variables, and we just color-coded the score plot by outcome. So in that example, PCA, it didn't know that you were going to color-code outcome later on. It's not going to, the latent variables from that PCA model, from those six variables, is just going to be whatever the PCA is. This, by including it, you're introducing some knowledge, okay, into the system. You're including some, this often happens, we add to our X matrix, the basic X matrix, but then we add columns with additional pieces of information that we want the model to help us with. Okay, so I think it's time for a break. Let's just have a short break. And then we'll come back and just take a look at the final PCA case study, and then I'll move on to the newer stuff. Start with the PCA just on the case study on page 14. That's the last PCA case study that to look at, and then I'll move on to the newer stuff. So in this case study, what's happening here is it's very interesting. It's a nice problem, this one. What happened is this company wanted to develop a new type of detergent, and they were not sure what surfactant to use. So detergent isn't just the soap and so on. There's also a few additives that go into it. So what they did is they went to, you can get vast databases of physical properties, and they collected 19 different chemical properties, measurements on 38 surfactants. So there's publicly available databases, and there's some private or paid for databases that you can go to and or buy and request the physical properties of different products. So for each row in your data matrix, so this is sample one or chemical number two, chemical three, four, five, you can go ask the supplier for the physical properties, and you can maybe get the density, and you can go get the electronegativity and pH at certain concentrations and so on. And they built out this matrix to have 19 different properties. So it's the data set that's called surfactants. And if you look at it, I don't know what many of these mean, but these were, a lot of these are critical points, or for example, the number of chains on the hydrocarbon, for example, or various properties of this organic compound. What they then went and did is they built a model on those data, and they selected 10 representative samples, and that's what I'm going to talk about now, is how they selected these 10 samples. And they took those 10, remember they had 38 that they started off with, they selected 10 of them for further testing, and then they got these Y values from those additional 10. That's why this area of the matrix is so empty. So when we're going to do a PCA now, we're just going to go do a PCA on all the columns up to log P. So we're going to exclude Y did and so on, and just build a PCA on these 19 measurements, because when you're taking these 19 measurements, as you can expect, a lot of them are going to be correlated with each other. You're not in a 19-dimensional space. You're probably going to be in a much smaller dimensional space. So what the purpose of this exercise is to look at is how do we select a smaller number of samples but still span all this space, all the, we're still really, we don't want to limit ourselves in any way, or by accident only take certain samples and then leave out some interesting areas. There could be an interesting region in these 38 rows that maybe gives us a better washing powder or a better product. So how can we plot out these 38 rows of data, or visualize these 38 rows of data, but still make sure when we do our experiments later on, these 10 experiments, that we're sampling so that we've got a representative sample. That's really what this comes down to, is getting a representative sample from a much larger data set. So we don't know how to sample representatively in the 38-dimensional space, but we're going to, in the 19-dimensional space, but we're going to convert this to a much smaller number, A, and then sample in this latent variable space. That's the key point in this exercise. So in the software then, we go File, New, and the surfactants data set. the first column again represents that number, so highlight that column and set that to be your primary identifier. And then after that you have molecular weight of the surfactant. So we've got molecular weights that go from some very high numbers to low numbers, the number of carbon atoms, and then there's various other properties that I'm not 100% clear on. There's some missing data over here. So when you consult these databases, they're not always going to have every single measurement on every single row that you've chosen. That's quite okay. If you were using other methods, traditional data analysis methods, you would have to throw out this entire row. But what if that particular solvent or surfactant, sorry, number six there, was really actually quite interesting? If you were using some traditional methods, you'd throw away that whole data row. But with PCA, you can still keep it, and if solvent 6 seems to be interesting later on, you can spend some money to go find what that data value is. But let's keep going here. So then we get all this other missing data from those last two columns. These were properties. So we're not interested in these, the Ys, just yet. We will use them actually for a case study at the end of today in the PLS section. For now, we're just going to build a PCA on all the first 19 columns. So let's just say okay, finish that up. And we should normally just go view all these columns to go see that we've pulled in the correct data, that they're correct. And then we say okay. Yeah, I'm going to exclude. Oh, you could exclude it back there, but there's another way to exclude them here. So I was just going to show that over here. No, the reason why I like to exclude it later is because here at least I have them now to re-include if I find them interesting. Later on, if you exclude them earlier, they're never available for all the rest of the time that you're working with this file. It's okay for now because we're only going to do PCA. So don't worry if you've already excluded them, don't worry. But if you do want to exclude it later, you go to variables over here, scroll down to the bottom, and you can select those last four rows and hit exclude. And then this column just verify that changes. So it's still a PCA model, as it tells you over there. And we've got a box. Yeah, so here, for example, I have 23 variables, but I've excluded 4, so that's k is equal to 19. So say OK. So say initial PCA. That guy. And it will tell you over here that, yeah, there's only 19 columns. Okay, so build an initial model over there. So each 2, 3, oh, there's lots of components. Let's go take a look at just T1, T2 to get an understanding of what's going on in these things. Anything interesting in those first two components? So remember, each one of these is one surfactant that we're considering doing experiments on. What would you say is the general, you've selected 38 rows, maybe you've asked your chemists, do you give me the top few surfactants you would consider for our trial? We want to develop this new washing powder. After you've gone and asked a few people, you've collected 38 of them, but looking at the first two dimensions, what do you notice about those 38 samples that you've got, that you've collected this week?
Don't have an outlier.
Not an outlier, no, but there's something.
Everything is correlated in this side.
There seems to be two clusters almost, right? There seems to be this region here, and there seems to be that region over there. If you've asked people to suggest different solvents, so you're evaluating new raw materials to use to make a new product from, you'd be kind of suspicious. Why is there this big gap over here? Right? Is it impossible to have a raw material over here? Or what is it about that, then why there's that gap? Or maybe you've gone and selected something that there's something there that you've overlooked. So let's, the first thing I would want to know is probably why these two clusters are separated like that. Why is there this separation between them? And what would you use? A loading spot would give you to a good approximation why those two are separate. It's good. So let's go take a look at, did you have a suggestion, Holly?
Oh, I was just going to say you could select one cluster and go contribution.
Yeah, I was going to come back to that. Okay, good. So we'll look at the loading plot first, and then we'll go and do what Holly suggested. So we've got the separation between this half and that half. So which variables would you think are related to the separation of those two clusters? Right, so the cluster in the bottom half had higher values of these properties and or low values of those, and then the other way around. The cluster up here had high values of these properties and low values of log P, red CC, and C. And that is in fact what the case was here. All those points up there had very high values of log P. It turns out to be, I don't remember now off the top of my head what log P was. But that would seem to be the major problem. And actually it turns out when they saw this, they said, well, log, we can't have, to make this detergent, those samples over here have too high a log P. We can't use that in our process anyway. So immediately that cluster out here is not a valid region. It's almost, we have to throw out those samples and just focus on the rest. But this was a nice way to show them of these 38 samples that they quickly saw what was the major separation between them. Now let's go see with Holly's suggestion, if we do two clusters and we do a group-to-group contribution. So select this group, say for example there. Oh, I should have included 18, I guess. So select this group, and then you select the other group. So you get, make sure you get a red cluster and a blue cluster, and then you can do your group-to-group contribution. Well, log P is actually one of the major ones, but I think log P is missing for one or more of those, so it happens to be that you can't, it doesn't show up as a contribution. But let's take a look. What we should see, though, is from the loadings plot, a good agreement with this contribution plot, right? Let's plot up the loadings plot again, and we'll try and show them side by side.
Why can't you plot, for instance, T1, T2, T3, three dimensional? I'm not sure if they support that.
Yeah, I think it's possible to plot three dimensions, but also, there could be well that there's a clustering in the third dimension.
Yeah.
We can go investigate T1 and T3 next. We'll do that after, and then you have to kind of mentally reconstruct the 3D picture for yourself. But very often, the clusters are not in so clear in T1 and T2. They're not clear in T1 and T3. They're not clear in T2 and T3. But if you plot three of them up and you start spinning that cube around, you can start to see a cluster because it's kind of diagonal in all the planes. Yeah. Some of the software does that. They have the 3D plotting capability. I don't think it's in here just yet.
Well, because T3 here has been like 15.
Yeah, that was going to be the next component to go investigate. Yeah, we'll definitely get to that. So let's take a look here. Remember we did that group-to-group contribution. If this was T1 and T2, we kind of did this group to this group. So we should see in the loadings plot the variables that have high weights in this group and low weights in this group should match with this diagonal direction over here. So let's go see. We've got molecular weight as this variable, and it's over here. So I'm brushing from this log to that data point. to the molecular weight shows up over here. Or in fact, we can just brush this whole group. So, so we've got those three in red, the five in red, and then this group over here in blue. So the contribution plot is showing exactly what we could have got from the loadings plot. And that's what we want to see, right? We would be a little bit worried if we didn't see that. Yeah, I guess I can add that data point. Now, it turns out that log P, which happens to be missing, it was this was really the main way that these chemists could easily say to each other that was what caused the separation between the two groups. Just unfortunately, one of the rows in that data set causes that to be missing.
Yeah, didn't we like just disregard that row?
Yeah, I would have to go back to the raw data. So we could go here to, I think it just turns out to be those last two rows. And then just make sure that we don't include observation 38 and 39 when we do those contributions. So let's see if we can do that actually quickly. So 38 and 39. Oh, they're right in the middle, so yeah, there's 38, and it's 39. Yeah, as long as you don't include those in it, then that would show up in the contribution part. Okay, so let's go see Tanusha's advice and look at T1 and T3. So I'm going to leave T1 and T2 up down there in the corner, and then we go to plot T1 and T3. So analyze, score plot, T1, T3, and series. So T3 explains 15% of the variance. And there doesn't seem to be an obvious clustering here. Yeah, so this is T1 versus T3 over here. So one way you could do is take this and put it into the in and out the board, and then this is up down. So this cluster here, let's just brush up here. That cluster over there is evenly spread above and beyond T3. So in the third dimension, we're probably not seeing some separation. But remember, we got how many components? I think there was like 8 or 9 here, right? 8. So T1, T2, T3, they're explaining up to 50%. Yeah, I would say maybe there's something in T4, and you could go look at the fourth component. But bearing in mind that we already know that that these observations down here are really not of interest. But what's happening is that they're forming that first component, or first and second component. We really want to exclude these observations and rebuild the model only on those, because we know already we're not going to be interested in these in the future. They have a log p value that we just cannot use in our process. So one thing you can go do then is select them and exclude them. So send those into the garbage there. And under work sets now, you should see those have been excluded. Say OK and build the second model. So we say exclude high log P observations. So we've got model 2 here now, and we can go build M2. So let's just verify N is equal to 30. Because previously we had 38 rows, now we have just 30. So there's still eight or nine components. Okay, and the first two components explain about 60%. Three components explain about 30%. About almost up to 80%, 78%. So let's go look at T1, T2 again. And you can also plot T1 and T3 up here.
Why do we eliminate the high log P's again?
Oh, in this, it was for this particular manufacturing company, high log P's weren't possible to use those surfactants in their process anyway.
Okay.
It's just they happened to select 38 solvents, but they didn't know ahead of time what all the 19 properties would be.
Okay.
So some, I guess someone said, try these solvents, then other person went and collected the data, and then they realized after the fact, okay, no, these are just too high values, we can't use this in our process.
Okay, so we found that there were missing data in our collected information, so how do we know that?
No, we found that through the scores, the T1, T2 plot.
Okay.
We plotted T1, T2, and we saw that cluster out there. Right, and then we, it just happened to be missing in that contribution plot, the group-to-group contribution.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And the brushing did help you to get the high log P effect on other points on the cluster.
Yeah, I was using the brushing to compare the contributions plot to the loadings plot.
Right
just to, because in, like, this is a good example where there's 19 variables in the data set. Sometimes you have 200-300 variables, especially for bigger batch data sets or for process data sets. So then brushing is really very helpful to find, especially when you've got the labels superimposed, then your whole plot is just a big mess, then the brushing really helps. Okay, so now we're down to 30 solvents, but we can't go test every 30 of them, right? We just don't have the budget to select 30 solvents. So if you had to go select a subset of those solvents, how would you go about it now? Yeah, that's perfect. If you want a representative sample, you know that this spans all the variation. You could go select solvent 20, 38, 15, 36, maybe one in the center. Then you could go plot T1 and T3, because T3 is also an important component. You've got 38 to 20% from the first two components, so that's 58-60% of the variance in the whole data set just from those two. But there is an important third component. So actually what you end up doing is you do a design experiment in the score space. So for those of you that have taken the undergraduate part, you go and literally construct a design experiment in the scores. Now obviously you can't go and find, there's not a data point, we would like a data point over there, but there isn't one over there. So you take the next closest one, 26. So you go do a DOE in the score space. And you could go and sample, in this case, T1, T2, and T3 become the factors. And then T3. So you go find, as best you can, the closest sample to high and low, high and low, high and low. So for T1, if I was choosing a minus sign, I would say minus T1 would be, say, a minus 4. So my low level would correspond to approximately a minus 4. And my high level, I would try to aim for a plus 4. And I go and find the closest observation with that combination of T1, T2, and T3. This, I find the point closest to that corner and so on. So then I've selected 8. And then maybe I'd select a center point as well. And there may be a reason that you can't find this data point, but you can find one over here and one over here, for just say. You probably can't find one out there, so you just take those two as a surrogate for that region of the scores.
We're looking at four components here.
Then you do a 2^4 factorial. Right? So here they ended up selecting 10 data points. So if I knew I had a budget just to do 10 samples, my closest factorials are 2^3, with a center point would give me 9 plus. Maybe then I'd just pick another data point. Anyway, maybe one out over here, or on that face. I would probably, if I had the luxury to choose an additional data point, I would choose another one in T1, because it explains the greatest source of variance. So maybe in T1, then I would try to maybe sample 3 times, or something like that, along those lines. Or maybe that someone said, you know, you can sample this one. This one, I think this one will work. Okay, so then maybe you include that. So it's ad hoc a little bit, but you're trying to structure it so you're making the best, you're spanning the space as best you can.
I think think this is the same idea in question one, and because some experiment is not available, so we get another point.
Oh, right, where you had to do the DOE.
We have 19 ones.
Yeah, no, that one was more what you were just analyzing the DOE data as after the fact. It was already available. Here you're saying I could run in these, I've got these 19 different properties. You are not going to do a 2 to the 19 minus something factorial, right? But we know that these 19 measurements are not independent either, right? So it doesn't make sense to go do a 2 to the 19 factorial anyway. I mean, of course, we know that there's just too many, but even a fractional factorial, you still wouldn't even do that because you're not in a 19-dimensional space. You don't have 19 independent factors to vary. As the PCA model shows you here, at most, there's A is equal to 9 by cross-validation, but by looking at the R-squared, I would be saying, well, you know, that 9th component explains 0.006. That's probably not an important component to go sampling. I would at most go up to 3 or 4 components and build a factorial in my score space. Select those solvents and then go and run my 10 experiments on those solvents. Now, for those of you that know a little bit about de-optimal designs, is de-optimal designs is you can go and give these score values, T1, T2, T3, T4, to your computer. And so you give it a data set with T1, T2, T3, and T4 for all your 30 observations. And for these de-optimal computer programs, you say to the computer software, find me 10 experiments that span the space. And it uses an algorithm called the candidate exchange algorithm that goes through and shuffles out and creates a set of 10 experiments that gives you the greatest X transpose X. It spans the greatest volume. But short of you going to do that, you could just go visually, go look at the scores plot, and by saying you will have the largest X transpose X, he's saying you're going to span the biggest space. That's really what the X transpose X is doing. So you can go do it manually and approximate what a computer algorithm would have done. Or you can just do it by saying, looking at this cube up here. Okay, so I wanted to cover at least these 6 case studies in PCA. They all, each one introduces some new feature of the software or some new idea that I really think are important for you to have as tools to use this PCA very effectively. Okay, so before I move on to the next section on PLS, any questions? Is there anything in these past case studies that you were a little bit unsure of, like the contributions, the loadings? We didn't really look at, in today's class, too much of SPE and T-squared, but we did look at those in the last class, so if you're not comfortable with those, then go through those exercises, please. Okay, so if there's no further points just yet, you all can always email me. If you've got any, if you go through these exercises and there's any doubts, just send me an email.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Maybe you don't want to answer it right now, but I've been curious about what's the difference between the VIP plot and the coefficients plot when you're doing
PLS. Okay. Yeah, I'm not going to answer it now. VIP is a tool that I'll try to cover in the next class or in the 4th class. Yeah, I just don't, I would, yeah, it's just, it's not in my notes.
Do you only have one Y though, is it the same?
Well, what the software has done here is that they've actually calculated VIPs for PCA. So this being a PCA model, you will get a VIP. And it shows you in this case that all your variables are important. PLS, there's a VIP for PLS as well, and that's calculated slightly differently. This is a VIP for PCA.
Yeah, the one in the take-home exam?
No, I lost my VIP.
No, you didn't, but...
Oh.
Maybe I should ask you anyway.
Okay.
Just that it was weird, because it came up with a VIP plot showing something like this, but all the 6 were important, even while we know they're very highly correlated. From the PLS to find the DSC, that should contribute very little.
Okay. Yeah, let's take a look at it different here, because this is a PCA VIP. I think in your case, in your example, you did a PLSTA. Yeah, so it's a little bit different. Okay,
just one quick question on this case. If you plot T2 and T3, and you see that the data set are clustered again,
yeah,
and then you plot the contribution comparing the B2 and B3 ones, what can you get out of that?
Well, what you
that clustering in different T's.
Yeah, what you probably find is that you can see it. It just depends on your point of view. There were probably two clusters in T1, T2, and T3. But when you look at it at T1 and T2, those two clusters are there, like this. So you don't see it from T1 and T2. But if you plot it at T1 versus T3, you're going to see two clusters. Or if you plot it like looking down, you're seeing T2, T3, you're going to see two clusters. So I'll just come back to this plot here. So you've got... What you might have is you may have a cluster over here, and you may have a cluster over here. But when you're looking at it from the point of view of T1 versus T2, the data points in these clusters doesn't look like anything. You're seeing it from this angle. But if you looked at it from T1, T2, T3, or T1, T3, those, you would see it broken apart. There's still two clusters in the data set, and you're still do in both T2 and T3, and T3 and T1, you'd still do the contribution plots, or just look at the loadings plots.
For instance, can you identify those variables contributing to clustering, or?
Yeah, you can always do a contribution plot in any of the scores. Whether you plot TI versus TJ, you can always do a contribution plot between any two groups. Yeah. And that would tell you why those two clusters exist, what's separating those two clusters. Yeah, we'll come back to this important topic actually in the next class on classification, or maybe we'll bump it over to the fourth class depending on time. But it is on my list to cover this session. Yeah. Okay. Anything else? Okay, I'm going to move on to just explaining PLS, and then I don't think I'm going to get too far today with it, but I was hoping I could, but we'll just make this go as far as we can. Okay, so just I'll just put up here, next class is next week, Monday, the same time, same venue, and then I'll talk a bit about this idea of classification is really clustering that Lucius mentioned. I've kind of mentioned a little bit about multivariate specifications, and then I particularly want to get to this topic of dynamic systems. I think some people have been asking that they're going to be looking at data sets which are time-based, and is there any advice or any discussion I can have about time-based data? So I'll talk a bit about that next class. Okay, so right now, up to now, we've only dealt with a single data set, X, and we've looked at PCA. So we've got this matrix with N rows and K columns, which we've called X. And then in the undergraduate classes, we say, well, if we wanted to do regression, we introduced, we had several classes of multiple linear regression then. And that works adequately, and in many cases, it works fine. We used it for the whole section of design and experiments, because when we do a DOE, we've got this X transpose X matrix that is perfectly orthogonal. So it meets all the assumptions from that least squares requires. Then I showed in the last class a bit how principal components regression can overcome the case when we have multiple linear regression with very highly correlated columns in X. So we've got two or three or more columns that move up and down together very, very tightly. And that's problematic in multiple linear regression, because when we form X transpose X, we're just not able to invert it. Or it becomes very close to being uninvertible. So what principal components regression does for us is it takes this X matrix, does PCA on it, and we reduce it down to a much smaller set of scores, A scores, And then we do multiple linear regression on those A scores onto our Y variable. Okay? PLS now is going to be a new tool that we're going to relate X directly to Y. And we're going to do it in one step. So let me just introduce that with some of these pictures. So we've got MLR where we're relating a single Y variable. MLR can only handle one Y variable at a time. And we construct X transpose X. We invert it over here, multiply by X transpose Y to get our matrix, or vector rather, of regression coefficients. And the variance of those regression coefficients, B, is equal to the X transpose X inverse times the standard error. So this variance becomes very high the moment you get correlated columns. And we went through a bit of that in the undergraduate classes and why that's problematic. So PCR is a two-step approach. The first step does PCA, builds the score matrix, which now has very nice properties. It's orthogonal, the T's are orthogonal. We can calculate the T's when there's missing data. We get this very, very attractive idea of an SPE and a T squared. So the moment we get our T's, we can calculate SPE and T squared, and then verify that this X is actually consistent before we go on and make the prediction from it. In many cases, people just go ahead and make their predictions of Y. The X's are actually not really appropriate to go make that prediction. But what this PCA model gives us that no other model does is it gives you two measures of consistency, the SPE and T squared. If those two are consistent, you go ahead and make your predictions onto Y. But you can see here what's happening. I mean, we're building this model first up to this point, and then we're building the model on this second half afterwards. There's no knowledge, and the multiple linear regression doesn't know that it's input variables or scores, right? It doesn't know. So when these T's are calculated from the PCA model, the PCA model also doesn't know that you're going to go on to a second step and use them for multiple linear regression. So these scores may not be the best set of predictors or the best sort of summary of X to go ahead and predict Y later on. There's probably a slightly better set of scores available, slightly better set of T's that can be calculated to make that prediction of Y. That's what PLS is going to do for us. PLS is going to suck in the information from X and from Y, simultaneously use the information in both X and Y to calculate those scores. Okay, that's the key difference between PCA and PLS. There's not very much that's different, other than the fact that we've got two data blocks, but we're using both data blocks simultaneously to calculate these scores. Okay, so if you're building a purely predictive model, say you're building a soft sensor for your distillation column, and you are using online measurements of temperature, pressure, and flow rate, and so on, those go in X. And then you would make your variable that you're trying to predict, say for example, the vapor pressure or some concentration, that would go into Y. Maybe it's just a single concentration, or actually as you can see here with PLS, another advantage is you can have more than one Y. Multiple linear regression and principal components regression can only handle a single Y. If you want to build a model for two Y's, you have to do it twice. Whereas PLS, you get a single model. It's not a two-step approach anymore. And also, if you've got many Y variables, you can build a single PLS model for all your Y's in one go. And we'll talk a bit about this, about when you might want to build a separate PLS for each Y anyway, or you might want to build a single model. We'll talk a bit about that problem later on.
Second question. We did that because we have missing the same LTNX. Because like the multiple linear regression, if we have missing that, we can do that, right?
Okay, so let's take a look at that. With multiple linear regression, if there's any missing values in a row of X, you have to throw that whole row out. With principal components regression, you don't. Principal components regression actually does handle missing data in X, because these scores can be calculated by the Nepal's algorithm when there's missing data. So No, it's not really why the advantage of PLS. PLS also handles missing data, but it's not the primary advantage. Over principal components regression, or going from principal components regression to PLS, your advantage are that you can build one model for many Ys, but more importantly is that these scores, T, what's really driving your system is calculated from both X and Y simultaneously. Okay? So that's why I've got the arrows pointing this way. This is when we build the model, we're using information from X and we're using information from Y at the same time to calculate those scores.
You say you're predicting the composition of the distillation cone, and there's delay time in between, like your measurement and the analyzer. You need to take account of that, or the model will do it.
Good point. We'll talk a bit about these time-based systems in the class next week. But obviously, when you build your model, you would put in the row of X, you would have your measurements set here, is taken at 12:05 in the afternoon. The corresponding row in Y needs to be the prediction of the concentration in your distillation column, also at 12:05. Right? Because you're going to be using in the future you're going to get a new row. You don't know what Y is at whatever, say the future time here is 1600. In the future, you don't know what that Y is. You want to make a prediction of that in real time. So yes, in general, you would build your model so that whatever's in each row in X and Y is consistent for that whole row. Okay? So this whole row must be due to the same phenomenon or the same observation or the same raw materials. You wouldn't go and shift your rows in X and Y for that.
But you know that when you take and analyze reading, it's delayed by a certain amount of time.
Good point. So when you assemble your X and Y, you have to obviously wait to collect. It's easy to collect your X and get it in real time, and then Y might take a few days or hours to collect. But then you build this model only after you've acquired the data.
Okay.
Yeah. In the future, of course, you make the very important point that you want to use this model in real time. But then you're going to get your X's in real time and make your prediction of Y in real time. And then you might get your lab analysis 8, 10, 12 hours later and confirm, okay, that was a good prediction.
If it isn't a good prediction, you have to rework the model.
Yeah, then it may be that SPE or T squared for this X's was really high. Right? So yeah, this is a perfect case of when you would use PLS is for the soft sensor problem of making these real-time predictions. Okay, so when people see these two blocks, their first question is, well, how do I know what goes in X and Y? Well, it's obvious for a prediction setup. For a prediction setup, you put in X, the data that you're always going to have available, and you put in Y, the thing that you're going to predict in the future, or the things might be more than one. But it's also possible to build a PLS model for other purposes. So usually, the general rule of thumb is to put in X what you always have available, and you put in Y the thing that you might not always have available in the future. But of course, when you build your model, you need all your X and Y data available. You can't have no Y data. I mean, you have to have some Y data to build your model. So, like I said here, the most common usage or common way to understand PLS is for prediction, and that's how I'll introduce it in the class for you. But in the future, when you look at some case studies, you can very much use a PLS model for monitoring your process, or for optimizing your process, or to develop a new product, or there's many, many, very, very many uses of PLS. So I'll try to cover a few of those in the next few classes. Okay, so as I said here, the advantages of a PCR is that it's a single model, it's fewer components often, and it's easier to interpret. And it's interesting why it's fewer components. I guess you can see it this way. When PCA builds the scores, it doesn't know that those scores are going to be required for prediction in the future. Right? So it calculates A scores from cross-validation.
But it might be that you only capture A is, in this case, 4. You capture 4 scores from cross-validation. But it might be that T5 and T6 are really the things that are useful for predicting Y. So when you calculate those first four scores from cross-validation, it of course doesn't know that you're going to use them for prediction. And otherwise it would have told you, no, you probably need T5 and T6 also to make your predictions. So often principal components regression, one issue with principal components regression is that people often have to overfit the PCA model here so that they capture many, many scores so that they can be sure that there's enough information inside these T's to predict Y. So PCA or PCR is often goes beyond the number of components required. And that makes it really tough to interpret because now you've got many scores to go and interpret. PLS, on the other hand, is going to capture all those scores in one go. So there's fewer of them and it's easier to interpret. And as I said here, PLS handles many Ys. And then the other very important point is that PLS, unlike multiple linear regression and unlike PCR, PLS assumes that there's error in X. All these other methods you've seen before all assume that X, they assume there's no error in X. They say X is measured perfectly. Well, X in engineering situations comes from thermocouples and flow rate measurements and all sorts of measurements that have lots of noise in it. PLS explicitly allows for error in the. It says, I know that X has error in it, and it's going to find those scores accounting for the error. Traditional regression methods assume that there's error in Y. I mean, we know that if you look at the least squares model, it says Y is equal to Y hat plus an error. So that says, I know Y is composed of two pieces, something that I can predict and error. So ordinary least squares or multiple linear regression or even PCR, they know that there's error in Y, but none of them assume that there's error in X. They all assume you've measured your X's without noise. PLS says, I'm going to have error in X, and I'm going to build a model for X, accounting for that error. Okay, so let's take a look at the PLS just in some comparisons to PCA. Like PCA, PLS also extracts the components sequentially. We calculate the first component, then you do cross-validation. You can verify, was that component useful? And if it was, then you can keep going and add a second component, do cross-validation again and check if that component adds value to the model, add the third component and the fourth component, and then you can stop. So PLS does exactly the same thing. It calculates these A columns sequentially, T1, T2, T3, T4, and it stops based on the same sort of rules, cross-validation rules. The only difference, of course, is that PLS calculates the T's from X and Y simultaneously. Now, this last point here is important to understand. The reason why PLS makes intuitive sense to us as engineers is that the X data and the Y data come from the same system. You're measuring this on a distillation column or on some reactor, or the data comes from the same system. So it doesn't matter what goes in X and what goes in Y. You've arbitrarily put certain columns in X and certain columns in Y. But all this information that you've got comes from the same underlying system. So it makes sense that when you calculate these latent variables, it uses all that data, combines it together, and calculates those latent variables. Because whatever those latent variables are, that usually the latent variables are things that drive our system and move it up and down and create these directions of variance. Whatever those latent variables are, it could be due to raw material impurities, due to the heat inputs onto the process, whatever's driving the energy direction in your plant, or it could just be the throughput, that in summer you produce more product than in winter. In winter you scale back the production
rate of the process. You produce fewer tons per hour in the winter. So that natural variability impacts the whole system. So it makes sense that we calculate these scores using X's and Y's simultaneously. If you look back, a little bit back at what PCR does this two-step approach. It says, I'm going to build a model for X, then use it to predict Y. So it's almost seeing it like it's from two systems. This part, the Earth step one, has no knowledge of what's going on in step two, and vice versa, whereas PLS is doing that all in one go for you. Okay? So any uncertainty up to this point, what's going on?
How did we get Y matrix?
So
we have the X matrix. We built our model to predict Y. But in this case, how we got the Y matrix?
Okay, so this is based on what we call the model building data, or the training data. You have to have a certain amount of X data and Y data available ahead of time. And then in the future, you assume I'm going to have a new row of X. So in the future, you get this new row of X. Then we're going to predict T nu from that. And then we're going to predict Y hat from that. We'll cover this in the next class, the actual mechanism. But when you build the model, the arrows go this way. You're using the data from X, and you're using the data from Y to build those scores. In the future, the arrows go this direction. You're using your new X vector, X nu, to predict your T nu, and then you use those T nu's to predict Y nu. It's the same as PCR. When you use PCR in the future, you're going to get an X nu, predict T nu, then you use your T nu and predict Y. But the difference with PCR is PCR calculates these two models separately. They have no knowledge of each other. PLS calculates those models in one go. So there's really a very little difference between PCR and PLS. The only major difference is this idea that it's not a two-step process, but it's a single process. That's the key difference between PCR and PLS. Okay, so if you understand PCR, it's a very small additional jump to go and understand what PLS is doing. Okay, so the objective function for PCA, remember, is to best explain the X space. That's what we've always done. We've built a model that can say, I'm going to calculate my scores, T, so I can write TP transpose, that's equal to X hat. That's the best prediction you can make of X. You calculate a matrix T of scores, a matrix P of loadings, and you predict your X hat. And X is equal to X hat plus an error. So that's what PCA is doing. Now, let me just step back here, actually. Just when you say this best explanation of X space, what we're also saying is, we're maximizing this and we're minimizing error. That would be the two equivalent things. PLS actually has three simultaneous objectives. So PCA is easier to understand because those scores are derived with one thing in mind, only explain X. It doesn't care where that loading vector goes, it moves that loading vector around until it finds the best direction to explain X. PLS has to do three things. It has to explain the X space as well, but it also explains the Y space, and it maximizes this relationship between the X and the Y. And that makes sense, right? Because PLS is often seen as a prediction model. You want this relationship between X and Y to have the greatest possible synergy or relationship. We'll use a more technical word for that next. Okay, so let me take a look at it a little bit mathematically. PCA, just coming back to PCA, when we say we want the best explanation of the X space, we show then
what that means is we're maximizing the variance of the scores. There's no other direction that gives us greater variance of the scores. Remember we showed in the undergrad class where we find this direction PA, then we project every point onto that loading vector, and then those scores have the greatest amount of variance. In other words, TA transpose TA. That's the variance of the scores. We can say that because TA has got a mean of zero, so the variance of the scores is just TA transpose TA. Actually, to be more honest or more correct, it could be T transpose T divided by N. But it's a constant, so we don't care about that. So we maximize TA transpose TA subject to the fact that the loadings must be of unit length. So there's no other loading that gives greater variance of T. Now, how did we get those scores? I used some geometry on the board last time. I showed it by the cosine of the angles. Or you can just see it as matrix algebra that you find the t's from the x's by multiplying by the p. So it's a linear combination of the x data given by those weights of p. So I want you to have that in your mind, because now you're going to see this just shows mathematically, when I say something like best explain the x space, mathematically, that's what I mean. Remember, PLS does three things. It explains the x space, the y space, and it maximizes this relationship. So we're going to see a little bit of extra math, because we have to now explain the x space and the y space, and then do that third step also. Okay, so PLS explains the x space. Let's take a look at that mathematically. Remember, for PCA, we had TA is equal to XA times PA. That was this thing over here. TA is equal to XA PA. That's how we got our scores. Okay. Now in PLS, we'll use a slightly different notation. We'll still call them scores, but we will change the P's to W's. So TA is equal to XA times WA, so that TA transpose TA is maximized. That does exactly what PCA does, right? PCA said, I want TA transpose TA to be maximum, subject to, and that's how I calculated my T's, subject to PA transpose PA equal to 1. Now with PLS, for the X space, we do exactly the same thing. Just we replace the P's by W's. We'll call them loadings as well for PLS. Or actually, more correctly, we'll call them weights. Could be one other way to distinguish it. So in PLS, we'll call them weights rather than loadings. Now that's the first objective of PLS. There's another objective, is to explain the y space. And notice the similarity here. We'll introduce a new set of scores called U's. Okay? So in PLS, we have two scores. We have T's and U's. In PCA, we just have T's. But in PLS, we have T's and U's. T's are for the x space and the U's are for the y space. But notice the similarity in the equations here. We'll calculate our scores for the y space by just multiplying y by the y space weights called c. Okay? So we'll introduce a new set of weights called c. Those c's are also constrained in the same way as w to have unit length. And the objective of PLS then is to maximize u transpose u, because what this means in English is we're maximizing the variance explained in the y space. This is saying maximize the variance explained in the x space. This says maximize the variance explained in the y space. Okay? So that's the second objective of PLS. And then the third objective said maximize the relationship between x and y. Okay? How do we put this in English in mathematics? Okay, let's take a look at that. So when we say maximize the relationship between two variables, two spaces,
what we're saying is covariance. So let me take a look at this. Let me just back up a second. We've got scores T and we've got scores U. The T's are for the X space, and so the T summarizes the X space, the U summarizes the Y's. The objective function of PLS does only one thing. I kind of said earlier it does three things, but we're going to see how one thing translates into three things. PLS does one thing mathematically. It maximizes the covariance between the T's and the U's. Okay, so that's going to actually, I'm going to show you how, if I say this, I'm actually doing three things, I'm not doing one thing. So Saad and I last week had a good discussion about covariance. Anyone remember what covariance means? So if I'm saying I'm maximizing the covariance between two variables, mathematically I'm saying something that looks like that. So I'm saying find me the greatest expectation between the t's and the u's accounting for their means. And symbolically, because t's have zero mean and u's have zero mean, it just comes out to that dot product, t transpose u. Okay, so this is in the notes. Now, what is covariance again? Which one of those two has a stronger covariance? 376, yeah. Does it mean anything to you? That number 376?
No. Unless it's related to something.
Yeah, I mean, if I tell you the code A is temperature and B is pressure, then, okay, it also depends on the units. You have to tell me the units that you've measured the temperature and pressure. If I go change the units, I'm going to get different covariance. So covariance by itself isn't really a useful thing. It is, the only use it has is when you're comparing the covariance on the same thing. We know that 376 is a stronger covariance than the 23.1. About the only thing we could say, if I plotted, in this case I've got A versus B, what might the plot of A versus B look like for the first case? More scattered. Whereas for the second case, you'd expect them to be very tight data points, or at least tighter than the first one. So you can't even tell how tight they are from this number. You can't even tell that. All you know is that this one is tighter than the other one. That's about all that covariance is useful for. Okay? But we remember this other thing. There's a link between covariance and correlation. Correlation is way easier to interpret. We know it goes between minus one. So if two variables have a correlation of close to minus one, it means something like this. That would be a correlation of approximately minus one. And a correlation of approximately zero would just be random stuff anywhere. That's a correlation of approximately zero. Okay, and a correlation of approximately plus one is a strong positive slope. So correlation is way easier to interpret. If I tell you this data has a correlation between A and B of 0.8, you can kind of picture in your mind what that looks like. And it's totally independent of the units. And it's applicable to any two variables, whether they're temperature, pressure, flow rates, whatever, it doesn't matter. You can always calculate the correlation and interpret it. Covariance is not so useful. Now that's the magic relationship between correlation and covariance. Correlation is a scaled or a normalized version of covariance. We take covariance and we divide it through by the variance of A and the variance of B. So that gets rid of the problems of the units, because if we change A from grams to kilograms, the denominator is going to cancel out that unit change for us. Okay? So correlation, you can verify this, that it runs from minus one to plus one if you scale the covariance that way. Okay? Now, if we're coming back to the objective function of PLS, PLS is maximizing the covariance between the t's, which were the scores for x, and the scores for y. Let's take a look at that. Well, firstly, let's just rearrange this line. So I'm just multiplying through by the variances, and I'm just switching my equation around. So I'm going to show this to you now in terms of covariance. Covariance is equal to the product of three things: the correlation, the variance of A, and the variance of B. Okay. So if PLS is maximizing the covariance between A and B, T and U rather. So I'm just substituting in TA is now A and U is B. So if PLS is maximizing that covariance number, which doesn't really mean anything to us, we can break that number down into three things that do mean something to us. Because we know how to interpret correlation, we know how to interpret variance, and we know how to interpret variance. So we can break this rather abstract concept down of maximizing covariance into three things that we can understand. So if it's maximizing covariance, what would you do? If you wanted to make that covariance number really big, how could you make it big?
Increase the variation.
Of
TA or UA.
Of UA or TA, yeah. So what that means is you have to maximize the TAs, you have to maximize the UAs, and you have to maximize the correlation. Okay, so what would the correlation look like between TA and UA? If you had to plot TA versus UA?
Positive.
Positive slope. It would look something like so, right? So you can achieve this greatest covariance by making sure your T's and U's have this positive relationship with each other, and that the T's, the variance of T's is maximized, and the variance of U's is maximized. So let's remember when we said the variance of T's are maximized, like with PCA, what we're doing here? We're maximizing variance of the T's. So you already understand what it means to maximize T's. You're basically fitting a model that best predicts the X space. And if you're maximizing U's, you're maximizing a model that, you're finding a model that best explains the Y space, okay? And if you're maximizing the correlation, you're making sure that those T's and U's have this strong relationship, positive relationship with each other. So PLS, when we say it's doing one thing, yes, it is. It's maximizing covariance, but you can break it down into three separate pieces. It's doing all these three things simultaneously. PCA, on the other hand, was just maximizing the covariance of, was just maximizing the variance of T, because PCA doesn't have a U score to deal with. PCA only has T's. PLS, we introduce this new U score, but then we have to do a few extra things with it. We have to make sure that it maximizes the Y explained, and we have to make sure that those T's and U's have the greatest covariance. So everyone kind of get a feeling for mathematically at least, how to interpret that equation. Great. So I guess I just repeated that rule here. So we're explaining the X space given by TA transpose TA, maximizing the Y space, we're maximizing that relationship. Okay, now what I described to you is what's called simple PLS. There's another very slight different variation, which we will actually use in the software. It's the Niepels form PLS. But if you've just got a single Y, these two things are equivalent. And your understanding of PLS is not impacted at all by this. Like what I've explained to you is, if you're interpreting it that way, you're interpreting it in the right way. It's a very, very small difference that I'm not going to cover just yet. Okay, so I want to do it geometrically as well. Like what we did for PCA in the undergraduate course, I just want to show it to you geometrically. So imagine we've got these 15, 16 data points. In the X space, you can plot, we've got 15 rows in X and 15 rows in Y. And in each one of them, we've got three columns for X and three columns for Y. So it's a theoretical or hypothetical example. A very small X space and a very small Y space, just so I can show it to you. Then we've centered the data, so we've centered the data at the mean, which is that purple point. Then we fit the first component. the first component has to maximize the variance explained in the X space. Okay? So we calculate these T's. For every data point, we calculate its Ti value, T, 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 T. For every data point, we calculate a T vector. That vector has to have, that T vector has to have maximum variance. We also calculate the U's for the Y space. So for each one of these data points, for each row in Y, we find its observation where it projects onto that direction given by the C vector. And those U's, U transpose U, or the variance of U's, must be maximal as well. And then the correlation between the T and those U vectors must be maximized. So you can kind of see what PLS is doing here. It has to find this direction. It's constrained to go through the mean, and it keeps moving this vector around till that covariance value is maximized. So it's doing all three objectives simultaneously. PCA only had to do one of those three things. PLS kind of has to make some sort of trade-off to find the optimal direction that meets that criteria of maximizing covariance. Okay? And then like PCA, once you've found the first component, you then calculate the second component, also constrained to go through the origin. And it, the second component, you call W2, is orthogonal to W1. So the W's are orthogonal in the X space. The C's are non-orthogonal. So that's where the small difference starts to come in. But don't worry yourself about it too much, because those C's are almost always very nearly orthogonal, but they're not forced to be orthogonal. So that's often like a little bit confusing sometimes to people, but you can generally see it as being mostly orthogonal. And then you fit a third component and a fourth component and so on. So I guess the only differences between PCA and PLS is we're doing everything twice. And we've called our loadings, we've called them weights, we've called them W's instead, and we've got weights for the Y space, and we've called them C's. And the other major difference is, of course, how we've calculated those. We've calculated it to maximize a slightly different objective function. In latent variable methods, if you study more latent variable methods, there's PCA, PLS, and there's a few others, they're distinguished by what their objective function is. PCA's objective function is to maximize the variance of X. PLS's objective function is to maximize the covariance between X and Y. Other latent variables have slightly different objective functions.
So with that C2, it doesn't have the constraint that has to be orthogonal to C1, but it still does have that constraint to maximize the covariance.
Yes.
Or the correlation, I guess, with W2, is that?
Well, the C's are just the direction vector. Then we go and project all our observations onto that and calculate the U's for the second component.
Oh, right.
Those T's and U's in the second component have to have maximum covariance.
Okay, so if you were just looking at the C1 and C2, then they would, if it didn't have to be orthogonal, it would be almost the same thing, right?
Yeah, it would actually be very hard to fit the Y space in if you had that constraint. Yeah, so it's necessary to relax that constraint. Yeah.
So the correlation brings it that way still, but
yeah, that's why it's often very nearly orthogonal, but if you force it that way, then you may actually have to have extra components. This gets around to it.
Okay,
so I want to at least, I know that we're kind of a little bit over time here, but I do want to at least cover this one example with you, at least on a conceptual level, and then show you how to build this model in the software. Now, the original example that I had, it's a very, very simple data set. I've asked you actually to build a multiple linear regression model in R and to build a principal components regression model in R with the same data and then compare it to the PLS model that you get from the software. So we won't have time to cover that in class, and I will do that next class, but I do also want to ask you to try it yourself at home and to even try some of the other PLS exercises. So before we leave today, I will show you how to build a PLS model so you can try the other exercises at home. Now I know also it's exams on Friday, but then maybe on Saturday or Sunday you've got free time. The weather's going to be awful, I hope, because I'm going to be marking, so you guys have to do something else. So let's just take a look at this one, at least this very tiny case study, so that you understand what's going on here. Okay, the three variables of interest, well, there's actually four variables, but taste is our Y variable. What's happening here is that these guys have cheese. So there's 30, I think there's 30 samples of cheese, cheddar cheese. And they measure the acetic acid level, the hydrogen sulfide level, and the lactic acid level of the cheese. So those are the three X's. So I plotted them here as a scatter plot of acetic acid, H2S, and lactic. So if you just focus on this 9 by 9 set of plots over here, you're getting a feeling for how your three X variables interact. And then your fourth variable, your Y variable, is actually taste. So looking just at that top three, what would you, how many, if you had to build a PCA just on that data, how many components would you expect?
Positive correlation.
So PCA is going to look for the greatest direction of variance. How, well, firstly, how are those three X's related to each other?
Positively
correlated. And how many components would you guess would be required to explain that those three variables?
One or two.
Yeah, probably one, maybe two. Right, so you can go and try that in the software. Import the full data set, exclude the taste variable, and build a PCA model just on the first three and verify that.
Also, the test has a positive.
Okay, great. So that's the next step is, if you now have to build a PLS model, thinking what we've just covered and I've just spoken about PLS, how many latent variables do you think are required for the PLS model?
One for the Y.
Because how are those components calculated? From X and Y simultaneously. Yeah. So it's going to try and explain X and Y.
So if you need two variables, should be two from here?
Yeah, so I mean it's the same two components,
yeah.
Right? You're not going to, it's not two,
yeah,
plus
two, by
two
one,
it's
yeah.
two in overall,
okay.
Right? So it's, and you may even find that you can get by with one component. Probably, because as you can see, the relationship between X is going to, like, well, firstly, if you, let's take a look at principal components regression. If you did a PCA on just those three X's, you're going to get a single latent variable, T1. Then you're going to go and do a multiple linear regression between T1 and Y, in this case, T1 and taste. And you're probably only going to find one component. You've used that one component to predict that taste. Now if you do PLS, PLS is very similar to principal components regression, except you're calculating those loadings at the same time, sorry, the scores at the same time. So you probably will find that you just need one component as well for PLS. Now, let's take a look at how you do that in the software. So this was my instructions to you earlier, and it's in the notes. Build the least squares model in R and look at the regression coefficients. That's very important. I want you to take a look at what R thinks, or not what R thinks, but what a least squares model's regression coefficients would look like. Particularly, I want you to go look at the confidence intervals for each of those regression coefficients. Is the least squares model, remember we say least squares has a problem when your three columns are highly correlated. Do you think these three columns are correlated? Those three X's. There's a pretty strong-ish degree of correlation between those X's. But so I want you to think what, take a look at least what R shows is the confidence interval for each of those regression coefficients. Actually, just off the top of your head, would you think that all three X's would be important? So the confidence interval for lactic acid, acetic acid, and H2S. Might you expect all three least squares? I'm getting a few blank stares, so let me just explain it to you this way. Y is equal to taste. So this is taste. We're saying we're going to fit an intercept plus E lactic times X lactic plus B H2S times X H2S plus B acetic times X acetic. So we're looking at whether B lactic, the upper and lower bounds for that confidence interval for the lactic acid term and the confidence interval for H2S. Remember, if these span zero, it says that these terms are not important. So would you or would you not expect that for all three of these, there's also B acetic? What would you expect these confidence intervals to look like? Just based on what you see here in the raw data, do all three variables look like they're important to Y? Look at the last row of plots. This is showing you how, which one's easier to look at? Yeah, this one's easier to look at. Because this is showing you acetic acid on the X axis and taste on the Y axis. So this is showing you the univariate relationship between acetic and taste, between H2S and taste, and between lactic acid and taste. So from a univariate perspective, what would you expect these confidence intervals to look like? Now, I just want you to think about that, and then go build the model in R and interpret it. Okay? Then the next one I want you to go do is to, there's the instructions here, to go build a principal components regression model in R. So use the PR comp function, and then take your T1 vector and use that in the least squares model to predict Y. And then lastly, I'm going to show you here step 3, how to build a PLS model. And then there's an additional instruction. Actually, this exercise is on page, it's on page 24 of the notes. So you've got all these instructions there to build and calculate the root mean squared error of estimation. And then compare R and SEE between PCR, least squares, and PLS. Okay, so let me go show you how to build a PLS model in the software. So that's going to be your homework in addition to the other exercises. You can go take a look at that. But let's go open up the software and open the data set called So there's our data, and just set that first column to be your primary identifier. And this should be 30 odd rows. You don't have to do anything to the taste column, just import it as an ordinary variable. Okay. Once you've imported it, we're going to set it as our Y variable later on. Okay, so you can go look at your raw data here for each of the four columns, but you still don't set Y here, you do Y later. So say OK. Save it. Okay, so we're seeing here, if right now we just had to click OK, we would end up with a PCA model on four variables. That's not what we want. When I ask you to go build a PCA model on the three variables, you should go and exclude taste and go build your PCA model. But I prefer you to do the PCA model in R, because you're gonna have to build a linear model in R afterwards. Remember, principal components regression, you do the PCA, and you're gonna take your scores and use that to build a least squares model. You can't build least squares models in the software. So you have to do your principal components regression in R so you can calculate those, get those T's, and then use those T's to do your least squares model. And actually, I gave you most of the code in the exercise here, in case you're not sure how. Okay, how do you create a Y variable in the software? What you do is you create what's called a new block. So under the blocks tab, click create new block. Okay? And you specify that this is a what block type, that this is going to be a Y block. So in the drop down over here, it changes to a Y block. And you can go call this over here, block name. I just rather than call it a new block, I just change that to Y also. And just go shove the taste variable into that side. So Y only consists of your taste variable. One other thing you have to go do is we've put the taste variable into Y, but it's actually still left behind in X. So just go back up to here, this time go up to variables, and just select taste and exclude that. Okay? So you've got 1, 2, 3 X's, and taste is in your Y block. Okay, so we'll just call this POS. And you should just verify that over here. I always just double check to make sure because sometimes you're not sure if it's gone and excluded or not. So there's 30 observations. K is the number of columns in our X space, is 3. And static Y, the number of variables, is 1. Okay. It's also got the static X here as 4 variables, but that's because there's 4 potential variables here. Yeah, there is just 1 actual variable. Okay, build your model. How many components did you expect? And so it explains about 60% of the variation. And a Q squared, these are interpreted in exactly the same way, Q squared and R squared, like you did for PCA. This is R squared for the Y space. Okay, PLS actually has also R squared X and Q squared X. It has the same set of R squares as PCA does, but it also has R squares for Y. And if you interpret like any other R squared. So what's the first thing you want to plot up once you build this model? How many, we said that there's one component. Let's go take a look at what that loadings direction looks like. Okay, now there's a little bit of a glitch here, not a glitch, I haven't quite explained everything to you about PLS. In particular, I've just called the weights W, but they're actually called W star. And I will explain to you in the next class why they're called W star. But for now, you can go plot the weights. They're called W star for the X space, and they're called C for the Y space. So that's the correct name for the Y space. There's a reason why they're called W star. I'll cover it next week. But all you need to know for now is that W star 1 is actually equal to W1. So it's not misleading in any way to look at W star 1. So the way you do that is you go to analyze and loading plot.
Okay. Yeah, regarding the 60% on the first component.
Yep.
Don't we need to go higher than 60 in order to explain the exact?
Okay.
Good interpretation.
No. Let me come show this.
Well,
and then
I'll add another component because I need to go higher than 60.
What are you aiming for something or where would you be satisfied that it ended up with?
About 80.
Okay. And why is 80%? I'm not trying to trick you. I just want to because you're not going to be the only one in the class that's thinking this. Everyone else is thinking I want everyone's aiming for high R squared. So 80% on what basis is that from? Yeah, it's an interesting question. I respond to mailing lists on the internet, and people always say, "Oh, I want R squared higher," and I always have these discussions with people. It's a bit misleading, and it comes from the problem that people always put their faith in R squared, and they want a high R squared. But the problem is, you know, this Y variable in this case is taste, so it's determined by a panel of judges. So if I'm giving the cheese a taste of 12, and you're giving it a 10, and Emily's giving it a 6, and then they use the average of that taste, and they come up with 8.5, and then we all three taste the next cheese, and we give it our own scores. How would you say the Y variable is behaved? Is it a good signal, or is it a noisy signal, or
noisy?
noisy signal. And if, I guess one thing you should say is you should ask yourself, if I'm giving the cheese a y equals to 12, what is that? Plus or minus how many standard deviations? How accurate is my measure of y? It could be a laboratory measure. There could be very carefully performed laboratory experiments for certain y's, and then your noise is very low. But otherwise, you've got very, very high degree of noise on the y, especially when it comes to these subjective things like tastes. So if you're aiming for 80% explained, but really maybe the true variance in that y variable is 60%. 40% of the y variable is actually noise. So if you're going and aiming and adding components to get to 80%, you're probably fitting noise. The problem is, what you and I can see where you're coming from is, most people don't always appreciate what's going on here with the y variable. And then secondly, you don't always know what is a good value for y. You don't know that is 60% a good R squared or is 80%? 80% R squared might be very poor in some analytical laboratory where they've calculated their y with very low error. So then if your model is predicting 80%, it's actually a very bad model. Conversely, there's situations like here where if you're able to predict a very high 60%, that's actually quite good. So that's why I don't like to aim for a particular target. And why the only way to test a model is to have testing data. So in fact, here in this particular case study, I asked you to go repeat all of this by leaving out 10 of the rows. You build your model on the first 20 and you calculate your prediction error for the last 10 rows. And then you compare that prediction error for PCA, PLS, and least squares. That's the only way to test a model is to use testing data. R squared is so misleading. That's why in the course you almost, I just mentioned it once and then I never mentioned it again. I don't like it. It's not worthwhile trying to aim for that. Okay, so that was a bit of a sideline. What I do want to just quickly show is how to plot the loadings. In PLS, when we plot the loadings, we plot the loadings for W stars for the X space and the C's are the loadings for the Y space. But what we often do, or almost always do, for PLS is we plot the two loadings plot on top of each other. Okay? So imagine we've got two components in our model. I would plot W star 1 on this axis, and I would plot W star 2 on this axis. This would be the equivalent of P1 and P2 if I was doing PCA. These are my x-space loadings, W star 1 and W star 2. I could also plot, in addition to this, C1 versus C2 to understand my loadings for the Y space. But what we almost always do is we just put the two on top of each other, and it's called W star 1 and W star 2. Okay? So some people say that that's W times C. It's very unfortunate notation that they've used star. It's not W times C. It's W star and C superimposed. That's all it is. Okay? So you've got your 0, 0 over here. In this particular case, we can only plot one component. There's only one component, so we have to plot it as a bar plot. We're plotting W star and C. Okay. So analyze, so you can go with me here, analyze loadings plot, change this to a bar plot, make sure that turns to range. And then you plot W star C1 as series. Okay. And what the software does is it shows you W star over here. And then it's got this vertical line, and that's the C. So the first three are the weights W star for the X space, for your three X variables. And then you've got the weight for your Y variable. Now, what do you interpret from that? If you just interpret the three x variables separately, because that's why we plot W star C on top of each other, so we can see the x space variables and the y space variables and the relationship between x and y. But let's just firstly go look at the x space variables. What do you see?
Everything is positive, like all positive correlation.
Okay, and was that what you expected from the, from the scatter plot, right? When we saw the raw data over here in this plot, you expect that. Because we saw how highly correlated those first three were. Now if you go look at the C and its relationship to the X's, it's showing you the Y spaces moving up and down with the X space. So as your cheese has more acetic acid, higher H2S, and higher lactic acid, the taste score given by the judges improves. So that's weird. Why are the judges giving cheeses with high H2S, a high score? Well, I guess if you eat cheese, you know why. So it shows you how your X's are related to Y. If you wanted to increase your Y variable, you would increase those three X's, or decrease those three X's to get a decrease in the Y. So this is a very, very simple example, conceptually and in the number of plots you have to do, that helps you understand a bit of PLS. So I think that those are the main tools you need to understand for this exercise. Now there's some shortcuts over here. There's WC1 bar plot that plots exactly the same that we just did now. Then there's the W star C1 versus C2. That won't work right now because we only have one component. Now, the other interesting plot is this one. This is going to plot T1 versus U1. Before I even show it to you, before you even plot it yourselves, what do you expect it to be?
Be positive correlation.
Because that's the objective function of PLS.
That's one.
So there's the covariance or correlation between T1 and U1. Okay? So there's a positive correlation between those two variables. And that was what, there's no other loading vector in the X space or Y space that will give you higher covariance between X and Y, between T1 and U1. Okay? So that's what PLS was maximizing. Now in some plots, this is very, very strong. And then in the second component, it gets weaker and weaker and weaker because that's, it has to, right? The first component has found the strongest direction, then the second strongest direction, and so on. So we always, or sometimes we look at the T1 versus U1 plots, and you should see the correlation getting weaker and weaker with every component. Okay? So that's about it for today. So I really like you guys to work through the exercises on page 24, 25, and 26 for next class. I will go through them with you, but if you can over the weekend, give it a shot. And you could also, if you want, if you're feeling intrepid, read some of the other notes that I didn't cover today, but I will go through those also.
It depends on the exam.
Oh, don't worry about the exam. Okay.